Let us begin with the brief order for confession and forgiveness. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Let us confess our sin to God, who is faithful and just, and who has promised to forgive our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
have mercy on us. We confess to you that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not trusted you with our whole heart. We have not loved one another in deed and in truth. In your compassion, forgive our sin, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our light and our truth. Amen.
With joy, I proclaim to you that Almighty God, rich in mercy, abundant in love, forgives you all your sin and grants you newness of life in Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
nature by the riches of your grace, and in the renewal of our lives, make known your glory through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Please be seated for the readings.
But woe to you who are rich,
for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Boy, Jesus can be annoying, can't he? When you read a text like that, so much of what Jesus says is wonderful. God loves us, forgives us, the kingdom of God is like a party. But then Jesus has this dark side that seems to want to make everything so hard. The sixth chapter of Luke includes Luke's version of the Beatitudes. Most of us prefer Matthew's kinder and gentler account. Matthew only offers the blessings. He skips all of those woes. I read a blog this week written by Rachel Keefe, and she makes many of the points to follow in this sermon. I think the Beatitudes get misused. We hear, blessed are the poor, and we all realize that none of us wants to be poor, right? Blessing or not. But when the Beatitudes are taken out of context, they allow people to reject our responsibility for living out what Jesus taught. These words too easily serve society rather than the work of liberating believers in Christ, setting us free from our sins. To understand, it is important to put these verses into context. So let's look at where Jesus was when he spoke these words and to whom it was he was speaking. Jesus had just spent a night in prayer, and in the morning, he called all of the disciples who were following him. And this was a large crowd of people. And he chose his 12 apostles from among them. And as they walked then down onto the plain, they came into another crowd of people from all over the area who had come for Jesus to teach them, to heal them. I mean, word does get around that Jesus had already healed a leper, a paralytic, many sicknesses. He had cast out demons already. And in the midst of all this growing crowd of people, Jesus speaks to his disciples. He speaks to those who are committed to following him. To his disciples, Jesus said, "When you are following me, you are blessed even when you are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Maybe he wanted them to remember that poverty is not a punishment from God. Who were those who were so desperately poor in their days? The leper, the sick, the lame, those possessed by demons. Not only were they poor, but they were also cast out from their community. Jesus comes to turn the ways of their society upside down. No longer would these people be outcast. Their lives became richer just through the healing that they received from Jesus. They were most likely still financially poor, perhaps in their lack of funds and community. They could take comfort in doing the work to bring the realm of God into being. Notice how important context is here. He's not saying that all people who are poor everywhere are blessed. This is not a blessing to be poor in general. However, when you are doing the work of God, you can find blessing
does that mean for how we treat those who are poor today? It's a good question. One for us to ponder as a church. So too, those who are blessed in their hunger, for they will be filled. Same context, Jesus is still speaking to his disciples. If they are hungry because they've given up so much to follow him, then they will find fulfillment. Generally, there's no blessing in being hungry. However, if you are hungry because you are bringing divine love into the world and you have sacrificed much, you might discover blessings in the growling of your stomach. On the other hand, those who are hungry because they have no way of getting food and they live in deplorable conditions, there's no blessing there. Are we not called to feed the hungry? Glamorizing poverty and hunger with a coating of blessing allows us to turn away from those who are hungry on our own streets. This next statement is equally challenging. There's no blessing in weeping unless you are weeping over the pain of following Jesus into all these uncomfortable places. If we weep because you've been loving and serving your neighbors, rejoicing is bound to follow. Otherwise, maybe not so much. Jesus is trying to comfort his followers, and the gospel writer is trying to give hope to those who are experiencing persecution by the authorities and rejection by friends and family. Otherwise, we are called to comfort those who mourn and to bear the burdens of those who weep. We can't just pass by and pretend that sadness and grief and despair or depression is somehow a blessing that will yield joy. Think of those who are outcast today in our society. Those who are in prison, those in a mental institution, how many of us go visit them? Are we comfortable putting them somewhere so we just don't have to look at them? Or do we weep with them and show them the love of God? When we move on to being blessed, when you are hated, excluded, reviled, or defamed, it's clear that the gospel writer is encouraging those who are being persecuted because of their faith. These words have been used to justify some pretty horrific deeds done in Jesus' name. So let's be careful about aligning ourselves with this particular blessing. If you are engaged in bringing divine love into the world and liberating those who are oppressed, you are hated and excluded and persecuted for it, and you can look for the blessing in that. Otherwise, you might just be a bully, causing harm unnecessarily by saying that you are acting on Jesus' behalf. Rejoicing will follow if you are truly serving God and neighbor. Otherwise, not so much. Oh, and then we have all the woes. Imagine Jesus saying these things to the 12. I picture them as adolescents who just might be struggling with giving up the reliable mealtimes and possessions that were part of their life at home. So Jesus spells it all out for them. Not only is it possible to find blessing in their poverty, there is also the probability of experiencing woe if they are rich, because that means that others are likely going without. If their bellies are full at this moment, then chances are pretty good that that someone close by is hungry. If you are rejoicing now while you are in the midst of a crowd that is full of poor, hungry, and sick people, then when you recognize what you have missed, you will weep. And if you are telling people what they want to hear, then woe is coming your way, because you aren't offering them anything in the way of liberating love. These Beatitudes are hard. They are hard words and lessons. They are descriptive of how Jesus is turning things upside down. They were meant for those who are committed to following Christ. They are meant to get us to pay attention to what it is we value and where our sense of happiness or blessing comes from. If it comes at the expense of our neighbors, then chances are that woe will follow. Being a disciple is not easy, and it should make us question the values of our society. If it doesn't, then chances are we are not really following Jesus. Amen.
Search the hearts of those who govern, that they lead with humility. sustain truth tellers and social movements that challenge society to become more honest and just. God in grace. Send me blessings and mercy upon those who long for consolation. Tend to those who are struggling with poverty, unemployment, or uncertainty. Provide for all who are hungry. Console those who face persecution. Grant peace to all who suffer. Especially those who are on our prayer list, those who are being allowed to stand before you today. God in grace.
You are our prayer.
Renew this congregation in our shared mission. As we plan and dream for the future we're preparing, inspire us by the examples of Martin Luther and all the reformers. Bless new projects and new ministry partnerships. God in grace.
You are our prayer.
Christ is raised from the dead, so we cling to the hope of the resurrection. We praise you for the lives of the saints who lived and died in the hope of eternal life with you. God of grace. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these in all of our prayers to you with confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Let us share God's peace with one another.
Lost souls that search for sin, lost souls that
should everywhere and always offer thanks and praise to you, O God, through Jesus Christ. Who is your light made manifest to all the nations. And so with the church on earth and all creation and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Mercy on us, mercy on us.
risen Lord.
Amen.
May God, who has brought us from death to life, fill you with great joy. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.